गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन, हाउ आर यू, कम ऑन, रिप्लाई फास्ट एवरीवन, जस्ट चेक द ऑडियो वंस, यू विल, ओके गुड, सो एम आई ऑडिबल टू यू गाइस, हाय, हेलो, हाउ आर यू प्रकाश, जस्ट प्लीज लेट मी नो इफ आई एम ऑडिबल, इट विल बी बेटर फॉर मी. Fine. Okay. Good. So today we are going to deal with the very important, one of the important chapter of your highway engineering. Okay. Last time I have taught you, I think, grade compensator, right? Grade compensated grade topic. So actually there were some topics that are left, they comprises of, I'll write it here, left topics. I know they were the summit curve, valley curve and your highway material. These are the topics that are left from our side, right? Actually what happened, for these two I have recorded the video, but somehow the video got disrupted, the audio got disrupted, so I have to record this again. So I'll try to provide it as soon as possible, either today or tomorrow. Positively there will be no delay, like after day after tomorrow you'll get it by tomorrow. Highway material you are going to get today itself, it has already been recorded, so no problem. And just go through the videos, the recorded ones, and you will, if you feel any difficulty or any doubt regarding the recorded videos, please come up to me or you can ask the question from Q&A section, right? I'm always open for your doubts. So these are your left out topics, so the video you will get soon. No issues. So shall we begin with our new topic, pavement design? Okay, good morning everyone. I think we are good to go now. Okay, so can you please tell me the type of pavements that we have, the most common two type of pavements? Please answer. Answers will be your from your side and explanation will be from my side, as we do every day. So please tell me two most common type of pavements. I'm waiting for the answers. Very easy question, I suppose. Good morning, Nandi. Flexible and rigid, good. So most common type of pavements are, like there are some more pavement, but two most common are your rigid and flexible. Good, Goku. So let's deal with the differences of both of these. I'll write down flexible this side and rigid here. So I want you to stay with me and help me in differentiating these two terms. So first let's talk about in reference to the flexural strength. Which one has more flexural strength? Please tell me, which one has more flexural strength? Flexural strength we are talking about. Which one has more flexural strength, flexible or rigid? You know what is flexural strength, right? If you have any doubt, please tell me, I'll tell you what is flexural strength. You can see up to here. ability to resist deformation on the application of load. This is your flexural strength definition. So please tell me which one has more flexural strength. Okay, no answers, no problem. Low or negligible flexural strength when we are talking about flexible pavement. Good, Goku. Rigid has high flexural strength. It can resist deformation. Okay, it has the... Good morning, Alvin. How are you? It can resist more deformation. It can't resist any deformation. As you know, you can easily see ditches on this type of pavement instead of this rigid pavement, right? In this, load is transferred through grain to grain. Okay, when we are talking about flexible, the load transfer is through grain to grain contact. And if we are coming here rigid, can you please tell me by which action the load is transferring? Load transfer by slab action, because it comprises of slab, cement concrete slab. So the theory which is valid for your slab load transfer action, it will be applicable in rigid pavement design. Acha, what about now joints? Which one of them comprise of joints? You will tell me, very easy and practical question. Which one of them comprise of joints and which one does not? Just please name the one which comprise of joints. I'm late, sir. Started warrant timing, sir. Alvin, there is the thing. I have conveyed only some things which were like, we have skipped some topics such as summit curve, valley curve and highway materials. The thing is, I have already recorded the video for highway material and it will be provided to you by today or tomorrow positively. And the video which was recorded for summit curve and valley curve, actually due to some technical error, the sound got abrupted in the video. So I have to record it again. After this session, I'm going to record that video and I'll provide the video today itself, otherwise tomorrow positively. So don't worry, okay? And after that, we have discussed the differences between flexible and rigid pavement. Till now, only three points have been discussed. So the question from my side was, joint is present in which of the pavement? It is easy. Please tell me. If deformation, I'm still waiting for the answer. If deformation is in bottom layer, same can be seen on top layer. Localized deformation. These points are very important. It can come directly or indirectly. Localized deformation are prevented. Okay, no answer, so I'll answer you. See, this is very easy. Whenever you see flexible pavement, the pavement which comprise of bitumen layer like on the top surface, it is flexural pavement. So whenever we are dealing with bitumen, obviously there is no joints in that case. So joint is absent in this case, and joint is present in this case, because we can't make a road by using only one slab. We have to take some pieces of slab, and if we are using the pieces of slab, then obviously joints will come into the picture. Any doubt regarding these four points, please tell me, and just tell me the number of the like point which you want to discuss again. If not, you can just note this down, or I can add one more point here, that night visibility. What should be the night visibility in case of your flexible pavement? It should be good or bad? Good or poor? What is happening today? Why nobody is answering? Am I not teaching correctly, or is there anything that you want me to put more efforts, anything like that? Because these are easy questions. You don't need like technical knowledge. You can just use, clear? Okay. You can just use some your practical observation. Night visibility is answers, please. In case of flexible pavement, what should be the night visibility scenario? Is it good or is it bad? Is it good or is it bad? I'm talking about flexible. Not good and flexible. Perfect answer by Goku is bad, and night visibility is good. In the beginning of your geometric design, I have already told you or mentioned you about this color thing and how it works at daytime or nighttime. You can watch the video if you want to. So write this down or take a screenshot. I'll move out of the frame for you for some time. Video is buffering. Okay. Just please tell me when it's done. Elvin, please tell me if it's still buffering. Or if it's bothering you much, then please tell me. I'll ask technical team. I suppose it's done. Just do one thing. There is nothing much to understand here. So please just write this down with me only. And try to learn these points here only. Because always remember, whenever the simple theory or simple concepts are being when I'm teaching you the simple concepts, try to learn them here only. You don't have to take extra time to learn easy concepts, because you already have so many concepts to learn or understand which are complex than these one. These are just differences between pavements. Okay, there are some more differences I'll mention quickly. Okay, we'll not waste time here. It should be 6, I suppose. IRC 37-2012 is used in the design of your flexible pavement, okay? And here, IRC 58-2011 is used for your rigid pavement. And it is important. Please note this down. In finite layer theory is used for stress analysis. Okay, and when it's come to your rigid pavement, elastic theory, because we are dealing with your cement concrete, elastic theory is used for stress analysis. Okay, so I think this is done. No more थिंग हाँ इम्पॉर्टेंट पॉइंट वन मोर इट कुड बी इम्पॉर्टेंट लाइक अच्छा प्लीज टेल मी विच वन ऑफ द रोड इज ईजी टू यूज जस्ट आफ्टर द कंस्ट्रक्शन और आई विल से विच वन नीड्स लेस टाइम टू यूज आफ्टर द कंस्ट्रक्शन इफ द फ्लेक्सिबल पेवमेंट और रिजिड पेवमेंट विद रीजन इफ रिजिड पेवमेंट टेक्स मोर टाइम इवन आफ्टर द कंस्ट्रक्शन इट कांट बी यूज देन वाई. So I have already answered you that road can be opened for traffic after 24 hours of completion. Flexible, okay. Asbar says flexible. Flexible can be opened like after 24 hours only. Okay, you can use the road after. There may be so many examples. There are so many examples in your practical life also. Sometimes what happen if you go like for 2-3 days you are going somewhere and when you come back to your hometown, you see there that some new roads are constructed within 2-3 days. People construct the road. Without any problem. So this is the only reason, because when it's flexible, when it's rigid, the road require at least 28 days to use, because it needs what it needs, rigid pavement time, as time is needed for setting of cement concrete, right? Because it needs curing. Since we are dealing with cement concrete, so it needs curing. And if we will not cure the cement concrete, shrinkage will happen and the cracks will occur and it will be of no use. So this is done for the differences. Note this down, then we'll move further. And please tell me when it's done. Just give me 1 minute. Done, I suppose. Okay. Can you please name me some more type of pavements other than flexible and rigid? First, I'll be happy to see if I'll get some answers which I am not aware of. Some more type of pavements other than flexible and rigid, please tell me. Semi-rigid, okay. Next, what about expenses? Asbar, actually what happens when we are dealing with flexible pavement, there is low initial cost, but the maintenance cost is high because it get disrupted or it get destroyed easily. And when it comes to cement concrete or your rigid pavement, your initial cost is high, but there is no maintenance required after once the road is constructed. So please note this down in your differences again, that your flexible pavement has low initial cost, but your maintenance cost is high in case of flexible one, and in rigid pavement, there is high initial cost, but there is no maintenance cost, okay? Okay, Asbar. other types of pavement. Just write down the names, no need to understand everything. Semi-rigid pavement, and other one is your other one is your composite pavement. Okay, this is what your rigid plus flexible. This is a key point when we are talking about composite, and it comprises of pozzolanic cement. We are going to study this particular topic very thoroughly when it will come in concrete technology. Please note this down so that we can move further. Done. Thank you. The video that are being recorded by me, I have done one thing for your convenience. After every topic, I have just moved out of the frame so that you can easily pause the video and look into the content, whatever is written over here. Okay, so I think now we can move to the thorough discussion on these type of pavement. So let's take design of rigid pavement first. Design of rigid pavement. Okay. Come on. Let's see. There are some, like what we can say, some topics or the whole concept or the whole information revolving around getting the thickness of the pavement. Okay. So for that, we have to first understand what is your modulus of subgrade reaction. And we can represent it by K. Actually, my intention was before getting introduced to this topic, I have given you the complete information about modulus of subgrade reaction when we were dealing with your highway material video. So if you will get the video today, then you will get to know what is modulus of subgrade reaction. I have explained modulus of subgrade reaction in that particular video. So go through that video, then you can use this. Otherwise, I can also tell you here right now, I'll give you some gist about this. Anyone can tell me, please? What do you know about modulus subgrade reaction? It will be better if I can get the answers from your side. Okay, I'll write the. It is used to measure the resistance of soil regarding deformation on application of load. Okay, so this is the information that you already needed, and remember, K is nothing but P upon delta here. Okay, and the standard value of this deformation that we take is 0.125 mm. Please remember, it's not actually mm, it's centimeter. Very important, very like oftenly they asked in the SSC examination. I have seen all the papers of this SSC examination from 2017. There were, I think, 6 or 8 set. So this question was repeated in many sets. So please look into this. Any doubt, please tell me. The unit will be kg per centimeter cube. Okay, so this was all about your modulus of subgrade reaction. Let's move to second term, which is your radius of relative stiffness. Also important, direct question was asked in the question paper. I guess the question paper was of 25th January evening, I think. Okay, so what was the thing represented by L? Only important thing is the formula EHQ 12K 1 minus mu square. Sorry. Square power 1/4. Direct formula was asked in the question. The options were given as like they change somewhere, they change this power, somewhere they change this power, somewhere they change this power, somewhere they took 12k at numerator side. But the only thing that they asked, there was no question regarding solution, like regarding the value of your relative stiffness. Okay, there was no direct question regarding the determination of radius of relative stiffness, but there was direct question on this formula. Very frequently asked, very important, do not forget this. Remember all the powers, remember the term which are on numerator and also on denominator side. Okay, I'll write E is your modulus of elasticity of concrete. Your H is thickness of pavement. What do we have here? K. K is your modulus of subgrade reaction. We have already discussed modulus of subgrade reaction, and mu we already have studied in your strength of material or mechanical structure. It is your Poisson's ratio. So they can ask you this also, that they'll give you the formula and they will ask you what does this mu means, what does this K means, or what does this E or H means. So remember this thing also. Note this down, then we'll move further. One of the important topic regarding rigid pavement, like this one is also important because this has been asked in the question paper, the recent one actually. And since there are so many question papers, so many sets, so definitely you can't say that this is not important. It can come in any set and you can get any set. Okay, let's move to the next topic of your design of rigid pavement. The approach of this information is completely this SSC and RRB. Do not think that I am teaching is irrelevant or it is not important for your SSC examination. I have seen the questions, that's why I am telling you. I am not teaching you directly without getting any knowledge of the examination. I myself gave the exam and I have the experience. okay, your value will be given in the question. It will be given in the question, no need to worry about the values. So next thing that arises here, stresses in rigid pavement, very small but important topic. Can you please tell me type of stresses, what I'm writing, type of stresses that the rigid pavement experiences? Please tell me. For your hint, I'll tell you there are only two stresses. Majorly, actually, there are two. You will give the name. I'll write it here. Warping friction. Okay. This is the part of some stress. Can you please name that particular stress, Goku? It comes under a certain stress. And there is one more stress. You are right with this. Warping is perfect. Okay, I'll tell you. The one major important stress is your wheel load stress. Wheel load stress, right? And the thing that Goku and Elvin you are saying is that comes under your temperature stress. Okay, and these both can be classified into further two points, as Goku have mentioned. One is your warping, and another one is your friction. Okay. Now we are going to deal with all these things. And can you please tell me the reason or the cause of this warping stress? Due to which this stresses comes into the picture in rigid pavement? Daily variation of temperature. Okay, this phenomena takes place due to daily variation of temperature. And what about the friction stress? Can anyone please tell? Daily variation of temperature cause warping. Perfect answer by Goku. And Goku, please tell me about this friction stress, how this comes into the picture, like in reference to this variation thing. And please, everyone just give the answer. Okay, we have the answer here from Goku again. Seasonal variation. Perfect. Due to seasonal variation. Good. See up to here. Okay. So, this takes place due to the daily variation of temperature, and this will take place due to the seasonal variation, right? Please note this down. I'm out of the frame. You can take screenshot. And please be interactive, everyone. Actually, today's session is not going on YouTube. Live is not going on YouTube, but it will be recorded and uploaded soon. So if you want to share this with your friend, you can refer this video. Wear and tear is the part of this stress itself. We are going to talk about it, Elvin. Before get into the stresses topic, you should know the parts of your slab, or you can say your rigid pavement slab. I'll just draw. Answers will be from your side. I'll only write it down on the board. please name A, B, and C here. Please name A, B, C. What is A? This is a cement concrete slab, right? And in reference to this, please name what is A, what is C, what is B. Okay, I'll write it for you. A is your interior of slab. B is your corner of slab. And C is your edge of slab. Interior, edge, C, edge. Okay, good, Goku and Alvin. Nice. Right answer. Note this down, then we'll see the nature of wheel load stress. This is going to be easy because everything is like practical. You must have seen it during your practical observation, so it won't be a problem to make you understand. So let's begin with the nature of wheel load stress. Okay, so there are two conditions when we are dealing with wheel load stress. Suppose this is your slab. Okay. And this is your wheel of that vehicle moving through this slab. So what will happen? Obviously, this will give one load here, and due to this, the deformed shape will be like this, like not this much, but yeah, it will deform like this only. Okay, so can you please tell me the top surface is experiencing which type of stress, compression or tensile? Please tell me which stress is it experiencing. Take your time. If answer will be from your side, it will be easy for you and me to make you understand that why it is happening. Compression on top, tension at bottom. Correct. Compression on top, tension at bottom. Okay, and let's move to second case when the wheel is now, when it's traveling like this. So first it was here, and at some point it will come at this point, at this point. So now what will happen? The new shape, the deflected shape, will look somehow like this. So now please tell me the type of or the nature of stress at top and bottom. Now tell me the nature of stress at top and bottom. Will it remain same or will it change? Answers from everyone. Yes. In this case, the top surface will experience tension and bottom will face your compression. Okay, any doubt regarding this, please tell me. I'll explain again. And now we will deal with the nature of your warping stresses. Note this down or draw the diagram. Easy one. Tension compression, right. So let's jump to nature of warping stress. Okay, so let's take first case. We are talking about daytime. This is your slab. And can you please tell me the temperature the top surface will face is more or less than the bottom surface? It's easy, so I'll tell you. Just temperature at top will be more and temperature at bottom layer will be less. So because of this, the shape will become like this, right? And now can you please tell me the nature of the stress at bottom and the top layer? Is it compressive or tensile? Here comes an interesting topic. Please tell me the nature of stress at top and bottom. What will be the nature of stress, compression and tension? Top tension and bottom compression, according to Goku. Okay. Anyone else? Please tell. Please try this. Just think once, okay? Use practical observation. Okay, so here's the thing in this case. Because of the temporal variation in the top and bottom layer, the slab is going to deform in this shape. Okay? By the shape, it is clear that the top is in tension and the bottom is in compression phase. But always remember, when this phenomena is taking place, the tendency of the slab is to remain intact at its original position. So the tendency of slab at top layer will be like this. It wants to come at its original position again. Like this. This will be the temperature, this will be the stress direction. And here it wants to attain or it wants to remain intact at its original position. So because of this, now we can say the top layer is under compression and this one is in tension. I know this will take some time to understand, but please tell me if you have any doubt. I'll explain this again. Important. That's why I'm telling you that you can ask me if you want to, if you want me to tell you again, please. Because the tendency was to remain in the original shape. That's why the slab is putting this much stress on the top layer. And the direction of the stresses can easily tell you that the above layer is experiencing compression and the bottom layer experiencing tension. Clear? Okay, very good. Very, very good. Nice. And now, if we'll move to your night time, things will work accordingly. I'll draw a slab here first. okay, and the shape will come somewhat like this, okay, because temperature here will be less and temperature here will be more, and the direction of the stresses will be something like this here and something like this here. So we can say above layer is in tension and bottom layer is in compression. If still have any doubt, please ask me, I'm here. I'll try another way to explain you, or just note this down if it's clear. And you can mention one note also. I need more space actually for this, so I'll write down here. You can see up to here, right? Note is your wheel load stress. We are comparing all the three stresses, okay, with each other. Always greater than your warping stress is always greater than your frictional stress. Because you can see these all the things, one thing is common, that they all are stresses, and the time of their loading will tell you their values. See, the wheel load is obviously more than the warping, since warping is your daily variation in comparison to your frictional, which is a seasonal variation phenomena. So this is more than this and this is more than this. Please note this down, then we'll move to our next topic, which is flexible pavement. If you have any doubt regarding the diagram, please tell me. Okay, clear? Let's move to your next topic. Today is your TOS doubt session at 5 PM, so be present at that time. We are going to discuss the doubts of highway as well as your TOS. In the study plan, it is mentioned TOS, but this is on my like personal priority that I am going to take doubts for both the subjects. So you can post your doubts up to 12 PM. I guess you still have some time. Okay. So now let's move to your flexible pavement design. Flexible pavement, right? Okay. So before beginning the flexible pavement design, you need to understand some points or some topics. And let's begin with the first topic, which is known as standard axle load. Standard axle load. Can anyone please tell me what do you mean by this standard axle load? If answer will be of, from your side, then it will be better. Please tell me, I'm waiting. What do you mean by standard axle load? And how much is the value of that standard axle load? Standard axle load for single axle dual wheel assembly is taken as 8170 kg, or you can say 8200 kg 4085, okay, 8.2 ton, or you can also say 82 kilo Newton. I'll draw the diagram here so that you can get better understanding. So this is your axle, and we are dealing with dual wheel assembly. One, this is rear axle of your vehicle. You must have seen somewhere that it has two wheels. Okay. 2050 kg, this one 2050 kg, this one 2050 kg, this one 2050 kg, and when you will add up, you will get 8200 kg. Okay, please note this down. Okay, so now we can move to the next topic, which is your stresses in case of your flexible pavement, and the topic is your stress at any depth z below wheel load. And this can be determined by your Bosignus theory, which is going to be thoroughly discussed in your soil mechanics. Just simply remember this formula. This stress at Z is given by your load into the stress into 1 minus z cube divided by a square z square. I have to refer my notes for this. 3/2, okay? Always remember just this formula. P is your contact pressure, and how you can calculate that? Wheel load divided by 2 pi A. A is your radius of contact. Okay, and always remember the shape of the contact between the tire and the pavement is oval in shape, but for the simplicity of calculation, we consider it as a complete circle. P is your wheel load. This is all for your stress. You can note this. Okay, so can anyone please tell me, or can anyone explain what is equivalent single wheel load. Equivalent single wheel load. By the name, it is clear, so I think it will be easy for you to answer. Equivalent single wheel load. No answers. Still waiting. Third topic is your equivalent. Single wheel load. Definition is in name only. Wheel load, equivalent, single. By the name, it's clear that it is the replacement of multiple wheels. Okay, we are replacing the load of multiple wheels by only one equivalent load. So this is your equivalent single wheel load. If I'll explain you, it will be somewhat like this. This is your rear assembly. Two tires. Okay. Radius of your tire. Radius of your tire, distance between both the tires. Okay, this is your, if this is your assembly, we are talking about this only. Okay, please do not get confused. We are talking about this. We are taking into consideration only this one. And 2A plus D is your S, you can say spacing between the tires. Okay, and if I will try to show you the stress distribution, so things will go like this. Here, here. Okay, and I'll shade out the common area. Right, so this will be your stress distribution in the case of this single axle dual wheel assembly. Okay, Z0, ZD by 2, and Z is equals to 2S. Z is your depth below the surface. Okay, and up to here, equivalent wheel load will be equals to P, and up to here it will be equals to your, can you see up to here, 2P. So only you have to remember this thing, up to which depth the equivalent single wheel load you have to only remember this up to which depth equivalent single wheel load is equals to your applied load of one wheel, and up to which depth it is equals to the twice of that load. S is your center to center spacing. D is your clear gap between wheels. For your better understanding, I'll mention it here also. F ESW. If the range is between 0 to D by 2, then it will be P. If it is between D by 2 to 2S, it will lie somewhere 2p, and when it will be z will be greater than 2s or equals to 2s, then your equivalent single wheel load will equals to 2p. This is important, please note this down so that we can move further. Direct question can come. After this, important topic is there known as rigidity factor. Please tell me when it's done. Okay, thank you so much. So now we are good to go for next topic, which is rigidity factor. Okay, so next topic, important, very important, rigidity factor. Please define rigidity factor for me. What do you mean by rigidity factor? Please, I need answers, because then there is no use of this live session. Then you can get easily get recorded classes. Please note, please tell me. Anyone? Contact pressure by tire pressure. Right answer, Alvin. So this is your numerical approach definition. Contact pressure by tire pressure. Or I can write it as CP by TP. Just giving a short name to this. Okay, now we can discuss what is your CP and what is your TP. Suppose this is your road surface and this is your tire. Okay, so there will be two pressures. One pressure will be acted by the surface, and this is known as contact pressure, and another one will be applied by the tire, and this is known as your tire pressure. Any doubts regarding this, please tell me. Explain you again, no problem at all. Okay, so here's question for you. Two cases. If CP is more than TP, then tires are in. Fill this blank. And second will be the contradictory, the opposite one. When TP is greater than CP, tires are in. So please tell me, tension and compression. A should be tension or B should be tension. Please tell me. You can clearly see from here. Firstly, we are talking about your CP is more than your tire pressure. Your contact pressure is more than the tire pressure. So in that case, what will happen? Just try to visualize practically that what will be the final result, what will be the stress that will tire will experience. If my contact pressure is more than tire pressure, so see what will happen if both if we are talking about both the pressure and the contact pressure is more, tension compression, okay. No, actually see what happens here, Alvin, my contact pressure is more, okay, so it is more, but it does not have the value to compensate this tire pressure. So what will happen, it will remain here, but it will try to push it. So when it will push it, the tire will come under compression. Because overall pressure going upward direction is greater than the overall pressure which is coming downward. So obviously it will compress the tire. And similarly for this case, when tire pressure is more, so in this case the downward pressure is more than the upward pressure, so tire will come under tension. Alvin, any doubt please tell me, and anyone else, if any doubt please tell me, very important. Clear? Okay. There is one more thing regarding rigidity factor that we need to understand. Like there is nothing to understand, they are just values. Note that values down when it could come in your exam. It was asked in some previous year question paper also. That's why I think it's important to tell you. So whenever we are dealing with rigidity factor, the pressure that we consider is your 7 kg per centimeter square. I'll write it here. TP, CP, and then your rigidity factor. Okay, so we are talking about 7 kg per centimeter square. When tire pressure is less than 7 kg per centimeter square, but the contact pressure is more than 7 kg per centimeter square, then the value of rigidity factor will be greater or lesser than 1. Answers will be from your side. I'm not going to tell you this time. Just look at the values and you know the formula of this rigidity factor. Now you are in the position of answering that whether it should be more than 1 or less than 1. More than 1, greater, okay, good Prakash, good Koku, just note this down. And remember that this case is considered for analysis. Yeah, less than 1 for second and equals to 1 for last case. You are right, Prakash. Thank you. Note this down, then we can move to the next topic, which is your design of flexible pavement. Today, we are going to finish the pavement design chapter. And we will be left, like from my side, we will be left for only your traffic engineering. Very interesting topic. I suppose it's done. if anyone here comes late, just please tell me that I have joined late. I will try to give you a summary of all the information that is given in your absence, okay? Survey class. Elvin, definitely the survey class is going to happen, and most positively I'm going to take survey. So let's see what plan is they are making, that technical team. This is not what I handle. I only handle this technical portion, okay? So no problem, I'll check with the schedule and I'll get back to you, okay? Okay, so we are dealing with design of flexible pavement. We have three methods. First is your empirical method. Even this could come in exam. Name the, or please tell us which one of the four options is your empirical method. Okay. Okay, yeah, tell me. Empirical method comprises of three tests. Can you name all them? Three methods. Second is semi-empirical method or semi-theoretical method. Only one method is here. Please name all these. Third is your theoretical method. Okay, so do we have answers here? Group index, CBR, okay, and one more. It is based on strength parameter okay. It is based on your stress and strain relationship, and the last one, it is based on your mathematical equation. California resistance. Yes, right. First is your group index method or GI method. Second is your CBR method, which is California bearing ratio method. Third is your California resistance value method. We have here triaxial method. And the last one is your Burmeister method. Note these down. We are going to see each and every test, like only the gist, the only which is important. We are not going to go thorough information. done. Okay. So now we are going to take one subject that I am aware of, which is going to begin after this, is your geotechnical, or you can say soil mechanics. Rest I'll check with the schedule and I'll tell you. GI method. Thorough description or discussion will be in your soil mechanics. Till now, only thing that you need to remember is A, B, D, A, C. 0.2 plus 0.01 plus 0.005. This is how I used to remember this formula, ABDAC, and then values are just getting half. 0.2, half is 1, half is 5.5. And here ABCD. Okay, you can take them as P minus 35 and B is your P minus 15, C is your liquidity, this limit minus your, I think it was 40, and when I'm talking about this, it is your P minus 40, no 40, it's 10, I think, it's 10 here. Not 40. Okay, and it has some limits, not greater than 40, not greater than 40, not greater than 20, not greater than 20. Please note this down, very important. P is percentage finer than 75 micron. And what else? WL is your liquid limit of soil. And we have your plasticity index, WL minus WP. And WP is your plastic limit. Please note this down, and we are going to do one numerical on this test. And there are some important 3 points I have to tell you. Just note this down and please tell me when it's done so that we can move further. Okay. I'll give you the information which is given in the question. Or first you just write this one. Note GI value. Can anyone tell me the GI value will vary up to which digit? GI value lies between which digit? Higher the GI value, poorer the soil. And thickness of pavement is function of GI value. The limit, please. It is 0 to 20. Please remember this, because this is very important when you are going to see your soil mechanics chapter. Okay, it's done, I think. Or I'll take the numerical in the important question discussion. There is nothing, you just have to put the values in the formula. Second is your California bearing ratio test. Test method, which can also be called as CBR. Okay, so in this case we have soil here, okay, it is filled with soil. This is your hammer or rammer, you can say, and it is filled with soil here. So what we are going to do here, we are going to plot the graph between the load and the deformation, the load that we are applying here and the deformation that that is taking place. So what we will do, eventually we will just draw this graph, which is your load and deformation graph, and the path that this graph follows is goes something like this. It could come in your examination, and we are concerned with only two deformations. One, when it's 2.5 millimeter, or second when it's 5.0 millimeter. Load at P1, load at 2.5 and load at 5 mm, right? So we are more concerned about these two deformation values. And numerically, if I define CBR, CBR is nothing, but it is your CBR percent. If I will define, it is your load taken by the sample, load taken by the sample at 2.5 mm. At 2.5 mm and 5.0 mm penetration, okay, divided by standard load taken by the aggregate at same penetration. I'll tell you this standard value, and it is really very important. I just rub the graph here, and this is really important that I'm going to tell you. First, let's talk about CBR percent for 2.5 mm penetration. Okay, so the load corresponding to 2.55, it will come here, and the standard load taken by the aggregate at 2.5 mm is 1370 kg, and since it's percent, multiply by 100. And similarly, CBR percent for 5 mm penetration, it is your P2 divided by 2055 kg. This is your standard load taken by the aggregate at the same penetration. Very important, very important. these two values. And when we are dealing in kg per centimeter square, like when we are dealing with pressure instead of load, then these value will be 70 kg per centimeter square and 105 kg per centimeter square. Very important. Please notice that I am telling you again and again, very important values to remember. These values corresponds to this much of penetration. And since we are having two CBR values here, so the confusion can arise which value we have to take for our analysis. So always take the higher values of this 2.5 mm or the 5 mm, like corresponding to 2.5 mm penetration and 5 mm penetration. Always choose the higher value, and in most of the cases 2.5 mm value will give you the higher value. Okay, 2.5 mm penetration will give you the higher value of CBR percent. If in case 5 mm deformation is giving you higher value of CBR percent in comparison to the 2.5 mm penetration, then you have to do the test again. And if the scenario remains same, that is the 5 mm percent or the 5 mm penetration value is again giving you the higher CBR percent than 2.5 mm, then go for this 5 mm penetration CBR value. Any doubt, please tell me. I'll explain you again slowly. If you have any doubt regarding this topic, which is California bearing ratio method. Rate of penetration (1.25 mm) per minute. It could also come in any form. Okay, so if it's clear, we can move further. And there is something that I need to tell you regarding this. You have seen the graph, the shape of graph already. So now we are going to talk about that graph, that how sometimes concavity is observed in the graph. Suppose this is your graph that we have discussed, load here, deformation here. Okay, so sometimes what happens, this graph goes like this. So you can see here, if I'll follow the path, it will intersect at this point. This is your 0 and this is your 0 dash. So why this concavity is coming during this test? Can anyone give me the reason why this concavity is introduced? The graph that we were supposed to get should have this shape. Why we are needed to just follow the path in the backward direction? Why we got this concavity? Anyone? And we have to take this as new origin when we'll follow the path in the backward direction. See what happens, there are two reasons for this. One is your soil is too soft. Or second is bottom of your plunger or plunger, whatever you like to pronunciate it. For me, it's plunger, or top of the soil surface is uneven. So these are the two points which are responsible for this introduction of concavity. Uneven top surface. Perfect answer by Goku. And yes, inclined penetration of plunger. This could be our one of the reason. So I suppose we are clear with this topic of California bearing ratio. There is nothing much about CRV. The next important method is your Burmeister method. Triaxial is also not important, even for gate. Very rare topic. You have copied it, right? Please tell me if not. I'll dictate that point. So now we are good to go for the discussion of Burmeister method, which was your theoretical method. Burmeister. The only thing that you need to know about this is it has some certain assumptions, okay? And assumptions are the going like this only, that material is your homogeneous and it is isotropic, and the layer of highway is semi-infinite. Semi-infinite means it has infinite like the length of the, like the longitudinal length is way larger or way longer than its thickness. So when this condition arises, we call it semi-infinite. Okay, so these are the two assumptions: semi-infinite layer, and second is your homogeneous material, homogeneous and isotropic. So here we get the deflection for two cases. First, if we are using wheel load test and flexible plate, in that case your deflection or your deformation can be represented as, just name it delta 1, it can be represented as 1.5 Pa by E. And in case we are using your rigid plate or plate load test, so in that case deflection, that is your delta 2, can be given as 1.18 Pa by E. Similarly, elastic modulus, and P is your pressure, contact pressure, A is your radius of contact pressure, right? Okay, semi-infinite means that length and width of pavement is considered infinite as compared to the, suppose this is your pavement, so the length, okay, and if I draw here, and the width, length and the width are considered infinite in comparison to the thickness of the pavement layer, okay? This will come in your soil mechanics also, but there we are going to talk about the soil layer instead of pavement. So we are also going to consider that layer is semi-infinite, which means the length and width are comparatively of infinite length in comparison to the thickness of your pavement. Goku, if still you have doubt, please tell me. And rest, please note this down. P is your pressure applied, it's not the contact pressure, it is the pressure applied during test on the plates. a is your radius of plate that we are using. Okay, P A, and we are left with E. Modulus of subgrade reaction. It's not reaction, it's just modulus of subgrade. Modulus of, I'll write it completely, modulus of elasticity of subgrade. This is not modulus of elasticity, that the previous one which was represented by K. It is different. Modulus of elasticity of subgrade. Okay, clear, Goku? Good. So this was all about your Burmeister method, and remember, this is really important. Please note this down. These two values are very important. Direct question can come, and the keywords will be flexible plate, rigid plate. You can easily calculate it without any calculator. Done? Okay. So the last topic of today's session will be the joints in your pavement. Okay. So first we are going to classify them. Classification of joints. Okay, and this classification will be based on direction. Please tell me the classification of joints based on their directions. Goku, Elvin, please tell me the answer. Prakash, classification of joints based on direction, specifically direction. Okay, good. First one is your longitudinal joint. It is along your length. By the name, it is clear. It is along the length. So, the first purpose of longitudinal joint, anyone can guess what is the purpose of this longitudinal joint? And it is obvious that we are talking about rigid pavement because there is no joints in case of flexible pavement. Answers, please. Purpose. Contraction joint. Relieve the part of warping stress. Okay. And the last one is your, it helps in lane demarcation. Okay. So these are three purposes. And can you please name the bar that we use in this type of joint? Anyone? Name of the bar that is used in this type of joint. Dowel bar. I'm talking about longitudinal joint. Please just check your answer once and please answer again. I'm waiting. Okay. Anyone else? See, dowel bar is not used in this type of joints. Yes, right answer is tie bars. Tie bars are used it is used to hold the CC slab, cement concrete slab, firmly at its position. Okay. Very important point. Tie bar does not act as load transfer member. Very important. Note this down so that we can move further. And the next thing that we are going to discuss is your transverse joint. Done? Okay. Please tell me type of joints that comes under the heading of transverse joint. Type of joints that comes under the heading of transverse joint. There are three in number, I'm telling you. Just give me the name. The last topic is for this session, transverse joints. Three joints. Names from your side, please. Contraction, expansion, and third one. You are right, I'll win. Expansion, contraction. One more. Anyone? Expansion correct, contraction correct, the last one. Construction. There is one thing that you need to note in tie bar, that tie bar is provided at mid height. Suppose these are two slabs, so the tie bar will be provided at this location, which is h by 2, if this whole height is h. Please note this down under the heading of tie bar. I forgot to tell you this point, please note this down, important. Now let's see one by one what is expansion joint, contraction joint, and construction joint. Although it is clear by the name itself, but still we need to discuss. Done? Okay, first I'm not rubbing this, I have space here. So first one is your expansion joint. Purpose is, it is provided to accommodate variation in length of your cement concrete slab. accommodate variation in length of cement concrete slab. Okay. And it is full depth joint like this. It is also a full depth joint. And third point, okay, tell me now, which type of bar are provided in this case? You have already said it, but for the wrong joint. But please answer it again. Let me see if anyone knows anything better or special or different, so that we can have a good discussion. Right. Everyone is coming up with the same answer, which is the right answer also. Double bar are provided, and they act as load transfer member. Okay. Note this down. Right, right, Goku, Elvin, right answer. Good. I have space here, so I can write this side. B is your contraction joint. First, note this down. Contraction joint we'll discuss. Provided to prevent shrinkage cracks. Not full depth joints, suppose this is your slab, so it is nothing, it's a groove. Okay, this cut is known as groove, and the length of this groove is given as 25% to 30% of total depth. Depth of this groove is 25% to 30% of total depth. Okay. And width is less than 3 mm, not less than 3 mm. Width is not less than 3 mm. This depth is 25 to 30% of the total depth, provided to prevent shrinkage crack development, and it's not a full depth joint. You can clearly see it's not a full depth joint. Just remember, this is important. Not full depth joint, this is full depth joint. Now let's see the last subtopic of today, which is construction joint. Any doubt till here? It is not filled up just because it is provided to prevent the shrinkage crack development here. Okay, so since we have seen the temporal variation, because of the temporal variation we have seen the deformations or the new deformed shape of the slab. So to accommodate that compression and tension, we have this groove so that it can easily accommodate that new shape, which could be because of the daytime which was compression upside, and the day, at night time it was compression downside. So if this because of this groove, it is more easy to accommodate that new shape, and without getting shrinkage cracks, it has the ability to resist that deformation. Okay, so this is why we are providing this half depth, not full depth. Correct. Third is your construction joint. By the name, it's clear. It is not any intentional joint. What happens? In a single day, you can't construct the whole road. So day one, you will construct up to some length, and then you'll go home. Next day, you will come and you'll begin the work from that particular location only. But up to that location, the road has already been constructed. So when you will begin the next construction, it will come with from here. So this joint is due to the labor, because they are not constructing it in a single go. So that's why this joint occurs, which is known as your construction joint. In simple word, we can say it occurs due to stopping and restarting of your concrete work. Occurs due to stopping and restarting of concrete work, right? And in this this joint also, dowel bar can be used for load transfer. Okay, and these are full depth joint because of this stopping and restarting. So we have only one joint which is not full depth joint. Always remember, full depth joint here. So these are the important points regarding your joints. So this was all for your pavement design chapter. Everything has been covered. Still you have any doubt or you feel anything that is left, please mention in the Q&A section. I will tell you in the next class, which is tomorrow, and from tomorrow we are going to begin our traffic engineering chapter. Really interesting chapter, and it will take 2 days to complete that particular chapter. So I think session went well. Okay, my only motive is to make the session more interactive, so it will be better if I can get more interaction from you people. Okay, because of you only I can get to know new things in my I can add new information in my knowledge. So I think everything went well. So thank you so much. I'll meet you at 5 p.m. in doubt session of your TOS. Also, I'll take the doubts for highway engineering if they are mentioned in the Q&A section. And I think everything is covered. And I'll try to get you the videos for summit curve and valley curve plus the highway material as soon as possible. Please go through those videos and please come next day and tell me if you have any doubts, because I can understand that was my first recording instead of live session. So now I can tell you that I prefer live session only, because I can ask you whether you are getting it or not. In that recording, I was just teaching the wall, and there was no one in front of me to ask me or to tell me anything that is need to be told. So thank you so much for today. I'll see you tomorrow session for highway engineering, and today for your doubt session. Okay, and keep practicing more and more questions. These topics required more practice of the questions. So it will be better if you can practice more and more questions and come up with the doubts. So thank you so much. I'll see you at 5 p.m. and tomorrow at 11 p.m. So thank you so much.